This video is about creating a Bode plot of an inductor. That is to say, plotting the impedance of the inductor, or the magnitude of the impedance of the inductor, as a function of frequency on a log-log plot. Now, as you may remember from a previous video, the impedance of an inductor is just a purely imaginary J omega L, where L is the inductance of that inductor. Now, for the sorts of inductors we use in this class, which are mainly fairly large inductors because we're working at pretty low frequencies, for instance, we may have a beefy one like one of these, there's going to be a fairly long piece of wire to get that large inductance that we have there. This is a 220 microhenry inductor on a ferrite bobbin. Because it's a fairly large inductance, long wire means there's a pretty large resistance to that wire. So we don't actually model inductors as pure inductors usually. We usually have to model the inductor in series with a resistor so that the impedance is R plus J omega L. Now, if you think about this thing in the complex plane, we're going to have R at DC, because when omega is zero, this part, the imaginary part, just disappears. And as omega gets larger, this is going to move straight up. So R plus J omega L is going to go off to infinity as omega goes to infinity. Okay, so to create the Bode plot, we're first going to need to know what's R and what's L. And what I'll do is try to get the specifications for this inductor. That inductor is a 220 microhenry inductor. But what's R? Well, one could try to measure it, but it's often easier to look things up on a data sheet. So let's look at DigiKey. DigiKey's got a fairly sophisticated parametric search facility here for finding inductors with particular inductance and other properties we might care about. So let's start with the inductance. I said that I was looking for a 220 microhenry. So I'll select that as a filter. We also wanted a pretty beefy one. And so we'll want a current, let's say we want a current of at least 1 amp. Okay, so we're now looking for a pretty large current rating. Now the current rating for an inductor is a measure really of how fat the wires are, how much current it can take before it gets too hot and acts like a fuse, melts the wire. There's another current rating here called the saturation current. This is a somewhat different property in that it's not a thermal property, but a property of the ferrite core that's in that center of that coil. When you get a large enough current there, you end up magnetic field getting about as intense as the ferrite core can handle. All the magnetic domains get oriented the same way, and it no longer serves to increase the magnetic field the way the ferrite core normally does. And so the inductance stops increasing. You start losing inductance as you get a DC current flowing through the coil. You can also get shielded or unshielded ones. We talked about this in a previous video where it's a question whether the bobbin has open sides or whether the magnetic field stays entirely within the ferrite core. DC resistance is related also to the current rating. Fatter wires give you a lower resistance and a larger current rating. Also, larger and heavier device. The only other one I'm going to check here, I think, is not surface mount, but through hole, so that I have something that I can stick in a breadboard rather than having to solder it onto a printed circuit board. So now I can apply all these filters, and it says there's 164 choices here. And as it turns out, the one that I was looking at was, I believe, this AIUR06221K. That was the device that I had bought before. It's about 75 cents a piece. Notice that's a 1.5 amp current rating. If I'd really only needed a 1 amp current rating, there was a cheaper device, 45 cents instead of 75 cents, that has a 1 amp rating from a different manufacturer. Let's take a look now at the data sheet for this AIUR06. So, there. Here, the data sheet has many different parts on the same data sheet. There's the whole entire series of the AIUR06 on here. And the one we're interested in is the one that ends with 221. If you remember, this thing's got the label 221K, and you can take a look. That's the inductance code in the last column. So you can find the 221K there to find the appropriate line. And that line tells us that we have, coming now in from the right, the temperature rise current, the maximum current there is 1.5 amps. The saturation current is 1.9 amps. So we hit the thermal limits on this one before we hit the saturation of the ferrite core. The DC resistance here is 2.52 ohms. So let me write that one down here. In addition to the 220 microhenries, I've also got 0.252 ohms. Okay, so we now have the information we need in order to do the Bode plot. Let's switch over to the terminal. First I should show you the definitions.gnuplot file. This is a file that you can download from the web. It's also in the textbook that is designed for creating Bode plots. The first part of it is setting it up as a log-log plot, putting the frequency on the x-axis, label for frequency on the x-axis, setting a reasonable x-range from 10 hertz to a megahertz, setting some formats and ticks to make it the axes look nice, putting the key on the bottom left, setting samples to 10,000 so we get a nice smooth curve, setting a grid so we can see easily where the where things happen, and then defining some functions. Voltage divider function, square root of minus one, some other stuff for dealing with just complex numbers, and then the formulas for impedance of a capacitor and an inductor. So we can use now, if we load this file, we can use it to get the impedance without having to write all the formulas over again. So I'm going to start with load definitions.gnuplot, get all those definitions that I just picked up from the file. Then I'm going to find L to be 220E minus 06, which is the 220 microhenries. Then the resistance, 252 milliohms, is 0.252. And then I'm just going to plot the absolute value, since I can't plot complex numbers, I have to take the absolute value of the impedance, which is ZL of X, L, X being the frequency and L being the inductance that I just defined two lines earlier, and then add the resistance to that. So doing that, I have a terminal here, and all I'll do is just run loadinductor.gnuplot to get a plot that looks like this. And there's several things about this plot that are worth looking at. First of all, let me now turn off a couple of these plots so I can draw some stuff in the background here. Okay. First of all plots for a resistor plus inductor like this are going to have pretty much the same shape. I'm going to start out horizontal and then go up with a slope of 1. That is to say, this line here is j omega l, this line here is r. And if you take the absolute value, the imaginary part just goes away there, and you have line here of omega l. You're going to get a corner here where these two things meet, and that corner is going to be where omega l is equal to r, or omega equals r over l, or if you prefer to do it in terms of corner frequencies, f equals r over 2 pi l. And you can see that the corner frequency here is going to go up if the resistance goes up. Take this line and move it up, it's going to hit the other line at a higher frequency. Similarly, if we take L and increase it, that's going to move this line up, and we will hit the R line at a lower frequency. So this corner frequency here makes a lot of sense for this shape. And now if you look at the gnuplot output there, you can see the resistance is coming in horizontally at about 0.252 ohms. And the corner seems to be somewhere around 100 hertz. So it might be interesting to go back to the definition here and say, well, let's change that X range. Let's look more around the corner frequencies. So let's try looking at lower frequencies, set X range. Let's go down to 0.1 hertz, and we don't need to go up so high. Let's just go up to 10 kilohertz. Okay, save that. And now we just need to rerun gnuplot. And we've now going from 100 millihertz to 10 kilohertz. And you can see that the corner here is, we now see the classic shape for the Bode plot for an inductor in series with a resistor. Obviously, one can change the name of what you're plotting here. One can change the y-axis and put a label on this, because this should really be labeled in ohms. And generally do the things we normally do to try to pretty up a plot to make it more easily read by our reader. But the basics of creating a Bode plot here are quite simple, and I think this video has pretty much covered everything we need to know on that.